Hi, everyone. My name's David Blass. So I'm the author of ArkType and a budding effect enthusiast. I've always had great respect for all the engineers on the team, and I'm super happy to be here and get to talk to you all about one of my favorite subjects in the world, which are discriminated unions and set-based types. So you've probably heard of discriminated unions before, I would think, if you write TypeScript. So I want to start by just throwing a question out to the audience, and no one has to like raise their hand or answer anything, but if you want to throw out a couple words, maybe, about like what you think about when you think of a discriminated union, like what's the first thing that comes to mind, potentially?
Pattern matching,
that's a great answer. We'll talk about that a little bit. Tags, yes, that's right. And I think that's pretty much what everyone thinks about, and that's one of the most useful ways to discriminate a union. But we're going to talk about sets, and we're going to go deeper, because there's a lot more to discriminated unions than tags. And you can discriminate a union in many ways, as we'll see. So to be able to understand any of this, we have to ask a much more fundamental question, which is, what is a type? And you know, I've got 10 minutes, so it's going to be a fast answer. But essentially, what we're trying to do here is create a more robust sort of set theory-based version of TypeScript. I find this very useful. I work a lot with TypeScript. As people are familiar with ArcType, know I had to get pretty familiar with TypeScript's type system. And to get intuitions about that, I find this model to be the closest thing. People often say TypeScript's behavior is crazy and unpredictable, and sometimes it is. But like, this is the default, and the things that don't behave this way are the exceptions, in my view. So let's talk about sets. So essentially, what a type defines is a set of values in TypeScript, a set of values that are allowed by a certain type. So you can see here, we have some very simple sets of values. This is more mathematically, you probably wouldn't have access to these types in TypeScript, but essentially you can see the natural numbers, and then we've got integers divisible by 2. Those sets are enumerated with some ellipses there for I didn't have time to write the full infinite sequence. And so then, but practically to express that, we need to express it in terms of constraints. And so you can break it down until you have atomic sets of constraints, which in this case would be the fact that a number is an integer, and that in one case it's greater than or equal to 0, and in the other case, that was my shorthand for divisible by 2. So then there's a couple fundamental operations on these atomic constraints that will help us understand how this is all going to come together. So the first, and I will spoil that it is the most important one, is intersection. You can do a lot with intersections. So it's very easy to define, but it's a little bit counterintuitive, and people get tripped up on this a lot. So this maybe will be a useful way to think about it, hopefully, if you take the intersection of L and R, if you're looking at those like values at the top there, the intersection would be the values that appear in both lists. So if you're looking at those lists, I have them, the values that would appear listed there, 0, 2, 4, et cetera. You don't get the negative numbers from there, and you don't get the odd numbers from there. But when you're thinking about constraints, that's where it gets a little tricky, because if you're thinking about an intersection of two sets of constraints, it actually flips, because the more you constrain a type, the fewer values satisfy that type. So essentially, it becomes a union, and you take a union of the constraints, right, adding them together and grouping them. So now we have this one type from adding together all those constraints and then deduplicating them because they're sets. So we have an integer, it's greater than or equal to 0, and it's divisible by 2. Yeah, so essentially, like, it's simple, but it's counterintuitive. And then honestly, like, that takes a long time to build the right idea about that. Even though it's a very simple model, every time you're trying to name something, you're like, am I constraining it, or am I like expanding it or extending it? And TypeScript's vocabulary doesn't always help with that. So good one to keep in mind. Unions, luckily, are much simpler in this regard. Essentially, it works exactly the way that you'd expect for values. You're adding together all the values that exist in either type. And the union of those two types is the sum of all those, not the reduced sum, but the enumeration of all those values. So luckily, with constraints, we're not going to, even if the thing turns into a giant blue screen again, it's going to be fine, because constraints for a union are very simple. You can't reduce them generally. So if you think about like unions with arbitrary sets of constraints tied to one another, you can't reduce that in a general case in the same way that you could reduce those others, which means that it's a lot easier to deal with them in this kind of type system. We're not going to talk about negation because TypeScript doesn't have it yet, but you know, maybe in the future we can pray. So these are the sets of constraints. We're going to do a very high-level overview of this. Essentially, there's two categories that you'd want to break that into. So shallow constraints are constraints that you could check essentially without looking at any of the keys of an object or a value. So TypeScript really only has two. Basically, like reference equality, or you think of like a unit type of, you know, the number one or null or something like that, or the kinds of types you get from type of, which mirror TypeScript keywords like object or string or number, things like that. There's lots of other things you could use as shallow constraints that TypeScript doesn't support. I have a list of them there. And the really cool thing is if you build a set-based type system, you can absolutely implement all those things, and ArkType does that. And it's a really, really beautiful problem to work on to see how they all fit together, but they all fit into this model. TypeScript just doesn't do them. Property constraints, you do have to check a key. There's fundamentally a couple unique types, which are literal keys that are named, index signatures, which are a non-enumerable key, like string, something like that, and then that has a specified type for each one that appears, and a sequence is a little bit unique because it depends on the previous items in a tuple or an array, so you can't even define it in terms of index. Those are the three fundamental types. We're going to go through this real quick and say that essentially you can, it's okay, you can infer everything from the intersection. This is the very, very elegant part that subtypes, supertypes, all that stuff, all you really need to know about any given constraint is the way it intersects with another instance of that constraint. You can infer all of this from the intersection. It's a really powerful idea, but what we're going to focus on here is item D, which maybe is on the screen now. That's great. So this is going to be the critical thing. So item D says that if L and R have an empty intersection, or what TypeScript would call never, it's an empty set. There's no values that satisfy it. Then we can actually use that in lots of powerful ways, even though it seems like a bad, dangerous thing. So now we're back to the beginning. We can answer the original question in a more robust way with this idea of set-based types. So hopefully this is relatively simple. So a union can be discriminated if the branches are disjoint. So right now, we're kind of thinking about a union being binary because that's the fundamental operation of a union, but you can just expand it by iterating it multiple times. So these are examples. I, again, only included two branches for simplicity, but these are examples of discriminated unions, and you can see the further down you go, there's things you would not think of as discriminated unions, but what it really means to discriminate two branches of a union is to know exactly which branch you're on by making a single check, and that means that there can be no values that those two branches have in common. So when you look at something like number less than one and number greater than two, it's actually a very intuitive way to have a range that has no overlap. But people would not think of that as a way to discriminate a union. But imagine you have thousands of properties on an object, and you don't want to go iterating over trying to find the first mistake because you have some union. You could actually use something like this quite easily to check and say, like, well, is it a number that's less than one? And then all of a sudden you know exactly which branch you're on, and you skip lots of unnecessary work. So you can do this partially and sequentially. It doesn't have to be, if you have 10 branches, that all branches are discriminatable from one another for this to be useful. Say five are discriminatable, then great, you've just saved yourself half the work of iterating over branches and trying to figure out which branch you're on. And they can be done sequentially. So even if you don't have one discriminator, you can iterate through parts of the union and discriminate it sequentially. Largely, that would be something you'd rely on probably library tooling to do, but it's very powerful as a strategy. So why should you care? Well, hopefully you already care, but if I haven't sold you yet, they're really, really powerful. The most obvious thing is that they can be checked in constant time instead of in linear time with respect to the number of branches on a union. So if you're thinking about validation, obviously, like, you know, checking a union with 100 members or 1,000 members or something like that is going to be a lot faster if you just skip right to the right branch and then check all the additional properties. Also much better for error messages, because generally you're going to have some kind of tag key or similar, especially in effect. And that will often be a very good indicator of which errors should be reported, as opposed to, like, it didn't meet this criteria because of this reason, it didn't meet this branch. I don't know if you've all seen TypeScript union errors, but they can really blow up sometimes and not be very useful. So if you haven't discriminated, you'll get much better errors. And then branch-dependent operations are something that I'll hint at a little bit in a minute. So quick overview of, like, how this kind of appears in practice. So TypeScript has some capabilities in this regard. It's a little bit different than a validator because it doesn't care about it doesn't care about that. It doesn't care about discriminating basically evaluating whether a particular value, a unit type, conforms to some type or not. It only cares about what you discriminate manually and determining if that's a valid discriminant check or not. So it does great with like nested discriminants and things like that. But there's still some things to be desired. You can't have a discriminant on a nested key. So those are kind of limitations of TypeScript. But that would be a perfectly valid way to discriminate those two branches. So hopefully again someday. In effect, I think there's some really awesome usage of discriminated unions, which unfortunately I don't have a huge amount of time to talk about. I think one of the coolest things is the ability to attach a property signature that automatically adds a discriminator. Because as I said, you know, certainly a tag is going to be one of the most useful ways to have a discriminated union that, you know, gives really clear results, and you can check the entire union in constant time that way. And so just being able to reuse an existing type and dynamically add a tag like that is a really great feature for leveraging these. And then pattern matching was mentioned earlier. Pattern matching is a huge application for discriminated unions. And again, it doesn't always have to be done in an explicit way where you've enumerated every possible tag. But the great thing, I mentioned unions can be checked in constant time if they're discriminated. Even with pattern matching, where there's an ordered union, you can still use all the information you know. And if two branches are disjoint, it doesn't matter what the order of those two branches are because they can't co-occur. So you can even check many pattern match expressions in constant time as well, which otherwise wouldn't really be possible in JavaScript. So ArkType leverages this quite a lot. This is very built into the roots of ArkType's type system. So it automatically discriminates unions to arbitrary depth. So we'll just keep iterating and finding the most efficient next discriminant of a union. And you can kind of see some nested switch statements, but the code's probably way too small for you to read if I had to guess. But essentially, the important thing is it does it for you. You just define a union like in TypeScript, and it will do all this kind of type-based analysis and figure out what checks it needs to make to give you the best error possible and be as fast as possible. And then the last thing I'll highlight is that there's also a very nice feature where I mentioned like branch-dependent transformations, where maybe you like really care about which branch you're on for some reason. For example, like let's say that I have a schema that wants to transform some data, and you know, based on which branch of a union I'm on, that transformation could be different. Well, I probably don't want like a non-deterministic schema or one that relies on the order of the union, because that's not what unions are about. They're supposed to be unordered. And so if you want to like have those kinds of strong guarantees about when you can transform data or when you can't, it's exactly when you can discriminate that branch of the union from every other branch. If you can guarantee that that branch has no overlapping values, then you're safe to transform it however you want, and you don't need to worry about non-determinism, which is a great thing to avoid when you're building a validator. So discriminate your unions. Use tools that leverage the power of discriminated unions. I think that honestly, the ecosystem is just starting to kind of explore this stuff now, and there's a lot to do. Work on that kind of code, leverage that kind of code. I assume you've all already joined the Effect Discord. I like to hang out there as well. Join the ArkType Discord if you haven't done that. And you're interested in this kind of thing, we're always talking about that. And then certainly, as I mentioned, I personally am very interested and passionate about this. So come talk to me anytime. And thanks so much, everyone.